Okay, so I think you can see it. I'm not really don't know if the presentation is okay. I can start. Thank you once again for a nice introduction. I would like to show you something what is a continuation of our research dealing with prenylated phenolics. I hope that will not be very boring for you, because each time I speak at conference, I talk about prenylated phenolics. This is a really topic of our main topic of our research, and we were thinking during the COVID time, the laboratory was majority of the last year, the laboratory was closed, and we were thinking how to continue with our research, and during getting deeper knowledge about the COVID disease, we started to think also about potential effect of natural compounds this area, and started to think if also our substances, our target substances, the prenylated phenolics, are not able to interact with the COVID disease. And we started to think first about the inflammation. We were watching the progress of the research on COVID, and found that the major complication of the COVID disease is the very huge inflammation, the so-called cytokine storm. This is a complication of the COVID connected with the damage of lungs, with triggering of really uncontrolled inflammation, with multi-organ failure, with disseminated intravascular coagulation, and the respiratory distress. And if we know that the inflammation can be acute inflammation, and such as a huge inflammation can be connected with the infection, doesn't matter if it's a viral infection or a bacterial infection, we started to think if our compounds, which we know are acting against the inflammation, if these are not useful also as a substances interacting with SARS-2, the COVID disease. The knowledge about COVID and about the virus is nowadays growing. There are several possible therapeutic approaches which were presented. Here I show a review article from, if I remember well, 2020, which is gathering the information about the possible therapeutic strategies. And if you see, there are many compounds which can hit the progress of the COVID disease, including the inflammation, on several stages. So there is a possibility to interact directly with the virus using some SARS-CoV-2 antibodies. There can be interaction with that ACE2 receptor, blocking the ACE2 receptor. There is possible interaction with the replication of the virus, with the proteolysis. There are compounds which can interact later with the STET1 or STET2 to inhibit this pathway, to suppress the inflammation. So there are different therapeutic targets connected with the COVID disease, and we were started to search the literature to find some connection of prenylated phenolics and any of these possible therapeutic targets. And during this search, we found attempt to make a virtual screening on of different, not only prenylated, but in general natural compounds, including many phenolics and including also prenylated phenolics. We found previous attempts to find compounds able to inhibit or interact with some therapeutically important enzymes. And here you can see that we were able to identify some compounds, for example, from Paulownia tomentosa, what is a tree which is connected with production of many prenylated flavonoids. We found a paper which was dealing with evaluation of different phenolic compounds from Brusonetsia, which is from Moraceae plant family and which is which contains also prenylated phenolics. And we found that there is a chance to find compounds which can interact with different coronavirus proteases, compounds which are coronavirus protease inhibitors. But what is true, we found only, let's say, really in vitro screenings and virtual in silico screenings. And we found no real information about capability of these compounds to kill the virus. Everything was done on the that time, everything was done on the level of protein or in silico. And therefore our idea was to go to our compounds library. Fortunately, and I will show you later, we found that we have a library of compounds matching the literature information. And we started to think if our compounds are not able to really interact with the proteases connected with the entering of coronavirus into target cells, and in parallel to block the cytokine storm connected with overproduction of tumor necrosis factor, or overproduction of interleukin 6. And later, this is, as we know, it's leading to acute respiratory distress syndrome, to multi-organ failure, to coagulation, embolia, and all complications which are typical for the complicated COVID disease. If you check it, we have a series of prenylated compounds. The prenylated substances, the prenylated phenols, are based on the phenolic skeleton. So it's an aromatic ring with the presence of one or multiple hydroxyls. These can be or free or can be somehow substituted with or a methoxy or, for example, prenyl group. And you can see that there can be typically 5 or 10 carbon side chain, which can be further modified in different way, for example, by oxidation. And later there can be observed also forming of the simple piran or furan ring. We went to our library of compounds, and as I said, we were able to find compounds matching the literature information. We had a series of compounds isolated from Paulownia tomentosa fruits. On the surface of these fruits, you can find a sticky resin rich in prenylated flavonoids. These flavonoids are typically substituted at position 6 by a geranyl side chain. The ring B of the flavonoid can have a different substitution, and there are many possible modification of the side chain. That is possible to find compounds with the piran ring. The cyclization can occur also at the end of the side chain, and nowadays I think we have something like 50 different geranylated or prenylated flavonoids obtained from this plant. And what we know, this is these compounds were able to interact with the inflammatory process. We know that these compounds can affect both the chronic and the acute inflammation because they are able to interact with activity of cyclooxygenases and lipooxygenases, and they are also interacting via inhibition of the activation and nuclear translocation of the nuclear factor kappa B, which is the keystone of the inflammatory reaction, and therefore they are able to inhibit the production of tumor necrosis factor and the production of the interleukin, both interleukin 1 beta and, for example, also interleukin 6. And we know that these compounds are able to do it also in vivo in a short-term test of anti-inflammatory activity. We did two types of assays. One was based on the triggering of inflammation in colon of the mice and suppression of the colonic inflammation. The second was a very simple assay done on the mice on the poedema, the acute inflammation triggered by administration of carrageenan into the paw. And we know that these compounds are able to relatively effectively inhibit inflammation. Further, we now know that also compounds from Brucellosia papyrifera are able to work in the similar manner. They are able to interact with NF-kappa-B to inhibit the production of interleukin 1 beta and tumor necrosis factor alpha in activated macrophages. They are able to suppress the formation of radical oxygen species. So again, things connected with the both acute and possibly also chronic inflammation. The spectrum of compounds from Brucellosia is a little bit broader, and here you can see two types of compounds, or both flavonoids, or let's say prenylated flavonols, and also group of so-called diphenyl propanes, represented, for example, by a group of so-called casinols. Brucellosia papyrifera is again a traditional plant. We are able to cultivate also in the conditions of Central Europe. We have this plant in our greenhouse, and we are able to obtain a relatively big amount of the wood. It's quickly growing plant, and we can isolate relatively big amounts of these compounds from the wood. And the last plant we wanted to somehow test was Morus alba, the Morus alba root bark. Here also you can see a bunch of compounds which we were able to isolate, compounds of the flavonoid type, compounds of the 2-aryl benzofurin type, and so-called Diels alder adducts. And these compounds were again tested, and we know that they have a good activity against inflammation. We know that they are able to inhibit COX-2, and more, what we found, they are also able to suppress the replication of herpes simplex. So we were looking to literature to also here confirm some, let's say, anti-coronavirus activity, but we were not able, but we started to think, okay, herpes simplex is a virus of the different family, but maybe there is some connection, and the anti-herpes activity can be somehow observed also for the coronavirus. So we selected a group of compounds to be tested. Here we can see a list, shortened list of compounds which we identified from the literature to be possibly active, a group of compounds from the Brucellosia papyrifera, these casinols and some flavonoid substances, we were able to use compounds from the group of aryl benzyl furans, and again here flavones and some geranylated flavones, and we also wanted to test some compounds from Pavlovnia tomentosa, some of these newly identified, like for example tomentum 2. This compound was new for us and we had no idea about the activity. As an addition, we started to think also about utilization of our small library of compounds obtained from cannabis. The number of substances which we isolated is growing. Now, if I remember well, we have something like 20 compounds, but we have a limited space for testing. So we, for the first testing of the antiviral activity, selected canflavin B, which is structurally somehow similar to flavonoids, prenylated flavonoids obtained from other selected plants. So this was the list of compounds which we started to test. We first evaluated the cytotoxicity by a simple MTT assay. The test was relatively quick and simple because we just wanted to know if the compounds which we would like to test further for the antiviral activity, if they are toxic, because later we wanted to calculate the selectivity index. And if you check it at the cons, we checked just two concentrations for the starting assays. At the concentration of 100 micromoles, a majority of compounds with exception of compound 8 and 9 were relatively toxic, but to tell the truth, which nature compound just is not toxic at 100 micromoles. It's quite common to see some toxicity. When we decrease the concentration to 50 micromoles, you can see that the toxicity was especially for the compound 6, 7, 8 and 9 for compounds obtained from the Brusonecia was negligible, and for the concentration 50 micromoles was quite okay for further assays which we planned with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. We luckily have friends at the Veterinary Research Institute, and in a few previous months they established a new laboratory for the testing of antiviral activity. This is relatively complicated to test something against the real clinical sample of coronavirus, because you need the biohazard level safety level 3 laboratory, and to find and to gather all papers necessary for the routine testing was relatively complicated, but because they are kind, they are friends, we were able to enter the laboratory and to make basic assays. We started with these compounds at a concentration of 50 micromoles. The test is relatively simple. It's a standard plug antiviral assay. Compounds of interest are incubated with vero cells. Then they are infected with a virus, further incubated, and later the medium which is taken from the infected cells is switched into a new set of cells which are then used to count the number of plaques, and the number of plaques is then recalculated to a viral titer. And as you can see here, if you compare it with untreated cells infected with the virus, compounds at 50 micromoles, especially casinols, casinol M, casinol N, and then also the Q1on E, were relatively effectively at 50 micromoles able to inhibit the replication of the SARS-CoV-2, the clinical isolate of SARS-CoV-2. And this was very promising for us. What is true, it took a lot of time to get these results. As I said, this is everything done in the biohazard safety level 3, so quite complicated work for persons who are doing these experiments. And we started to think about further assays on these casinos, and we the first thing was, okay, 50 micromoles, it's a relatively low, it's a relatively high concentration to see the effect. And so, okay, we did the assay on different concentrations of compounds, and you can see that at the concentration of 30 micromoles, it was still able to relatively well inhibit the replication of the SARS-CoV-2. So we were thinking the casinol and also other casinol compounds could be promising for further assay. We were thinking about the possibility of relatively low absorption of these very lipophilic compounds to vero cells, and therefore to see relatively low effectivity. And to improve the effectivity, we started to make some formulation of casinols into liposomes, and we were able to prepare liposomes, to test liposomes. The liposomes were very uniform. We were able to make a successful incorporation, and now we are running further experiments to evaluate the activity again, to see if the forming into liposomes is improving the effect. And this is all for today. I just wanted to summarize and to see some perspectives. Okay, we know that some of our compounds are able to inhibit the replication of SARS-CoV-2, but we still do not know the mechanism of antiviral effect. We have some idea from the literature search, but it must be confirmed by detailed research. So we would like to continue to isolate more prenylated compounds, especially these casinols from Brucellosia. We want to scale up the process to obtain sufficient amounts to later run these assays also on animals. We have now a contract with Academy of Science to continue with the research on our compounds or animals. And of course, we would like to develop an assay, let's say, advanced drug forms to improve activity of these compounds. And this is all. And I would like to thank my colleagues, which were mentioned on the first slide as co-authors of this work. And especially, I would like to thank two colleagues from Veterinary Research Institute. They kindly provided us with possibility to make the antiviral assays. We prepared a project for as a grant application, and we wait for the evaluation, and hopefully if it will be granted, we would like to continue to study the anti-COVID prenylated substances. So thanks once again for attention, and also of course to organizers to possibly